Welcome on Avatar: The Last Airbender. This is episode 15 of season 2. Very excited to see what's going to happen next, and how they're going to continue off the story. We've kind of been exploring Ba Sing Se a bit. Things aren't particularly ideal there, I think it's safe to say. They don't like talking about the war going on outside of the walls, and therefore not really excited to do much about it, which is a problem for Team Avatar. Who have this information that could change the shape of the war entirely. They're also looking for Appa there. No sign yet, but hopefully we'll get some movement on that fairly soon. Because we're kind of coming into like the last quarter of the season now. Oh, hello, my laptop's going a bit crazy. My laptop's excited too. But yeah, I am very intrigued to see how the story will continue, what they're going to tackle next. And yeah, Netflix, I'm watching it on Netflix today. And they've ordered the episodes very differently, and they've actually combined a couple of episodes together. So I panicked for a bit and thought I'd missed an episode because they've put this is like a different number, so I got a bit panicky. But I believe it is right. They've just merged 12 and 13 together, I think, as one long episode. But that's fine. That's on Netflix. But regardless, I'm excited. So let's get into the next one. Oh, Tale of Toph and Katara. What?
Toph, aren't you
Absolute
getting ready
mood.
for the day?
Whoops. Aw, this is kind of wholesome that they're just spending time together.
Wow, great makeup. Thanks. For a clown.
Kill them. They've gone too far.
Don't listen to them.
Says the bitch who looks like Mickey Mouse with that hair. Come on. Well deserved.
That was funny. Those girls don't know what they're talking about. I'm not looking for anyone's approval. I know who I am. That's what I really admire about you, Toph.
Aww,
you're so strong,
but she is.
Self-assured. You're really pretty. I am? Yeah, you are.
Cool. Hit me in the feels. So it's like splitting it up across people. I mean, I'm here for the Tale of Iroh. That should be the show.
May I suggest this lavender one?
No, it's not a romantic picnic, but it is a special occasion. The moonflower likes partial shade. From the vine, falling so slowly.
I love this guy. He's just going around making things better for everyone.
Run!
He's just where the kids.
I'm mugging you!
With that stance?
What? What are you talking about? Just give me your money, old man!
Give him your money.
No one has ever believed in me.
While it is always best to believe in oneself, a little help from others can be a great blessing.
Aw, he spent his whole day just like making people feel better. I want to be Iroh when I grow up.
Happy birthday, my son. If only I could have helped you. Lead from the vine.
I was just gonna say, is that why he was singing about the soldier boy coming home? You can't do this to me. Wasn't that the man who voiced him? I know he died.
You look hungry.
Oh, he is.
I wish I could get her a big open prairie like she likes and let her hop her way to
oh.
happiness.
Let's do it.
Is Appa in one of these?
There's a big open space.
Oh no. The cabbages! Oh, that poor man. I mean, I would have released them one at a time, but that's just me. It always is, buddy. Aww. That'd be me. He's freeing all the animals apart from the one he really wants to. Damn, look how good you're getting at earthbending. Whoa. Toph would be proud. Aww.
Bright love, sleet, her silver tears.
Poetry.
Oh!
Something struck me in the rear. I just wound up here.
It's a poem.
5, 7, then 5. Syllables mark a haiku. Remarkable oaf. In the spring, he climbs treetops and thinks himself tall.
Ooh.
You think you're so deep. Smart with your fancy little words? This is not so hard.
Ooh.
Fling that slang. I'm always right back at you. Like my boomerang.
I like that it's kind of like a rap battle.
That's right, I'm Sokka. It's pronounced with an Akka. Young ladies, I rocked ya!
Yeah, you killed it. Time to go.
One too many syllables there, bub.
And probably the wrong message as well. Oh, goodbye. I mean, you did really well for like 99% of that.
I was wondering if you would like to go out sometime.
Whoa.
I'd love to.
Great. I'll meet you in front of the shop at sundown.
Well, that's a good step to him making a connection with someone other than his uncle. Oh, wow.
Would you and your girlfriend care for dessert? She is not my girlfriend!
I've always wanted to learn how to juggle. Can you show me something?
Let's hope you're good.
I haven't practiced in a while.
The lamps make the water sparkle and reflect in the pool in the most beautiful way. I can't believe it. They aren't lit.
Oh no, what are we gonna do?
Close your eyes.
He can even do it silently. That's gotta take some focus. Are they going to sing that song from Tangled? Oh.
What's wrong?
Oh, he wanted more, but...
It's complicated. I have to go.
Aww. She seems sweet.
How was your light, Prestuko?
It was nice.
Aww. Aww. Aww, are you having a dream about your buddy and about food? Aww, it's the atmosphere. He misses his buddy! I'm gonna cry again in a minute. Uh-oh. Uh-oh. How dare you? Oh. No! Is that how he hears people? I was gonna say, you've got nimble fingers. You gonna set them free? No, Mo. That's very nice of you. Oh. Come and like sniff him out. It's an Appa footprint. Right? Well, that must be recent then. It must be close. Ah! No, I want more. I want more stories. I'm interested in seeing what the general consensus is about this one. I think that might be my favourite episode of the entire show so far. I bloody adored that. I think structurally it just works so well, kind of splitting it up like that. Because every single storyline, then you have a lot of storylines in there, obviously, but they're very kind of concise, very, you know, fast paced. You know, it's not like tying into too much, it's just checking in with these characters where they're at. Just going about some day-to-day life stuff, really. It wasn't like a huge plot thing. It wasn't about the conspiracies or whatever around Ba Sing Se or any of the problems they dealt with in the last episode. You know, nothing of that got really addressed or resolved. And we got a little bit, really, about Appa right at the end, because there's a footprint there, so we know he is around somewhere. But still not a huge indicator where. It was just them going about their business, and I bloody adored it. Because it's just, these characters are so strong. You can just do episodes like this, and I think it works. You know, I think if you enjoy characters enough and enjoy seeing characters together, I've said it lots before, but even if it's like not your favourite episode of a show or something, if you love those characters, I think you can still get a lot out of any episode if you just enjoy watching them do shit. Like, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., I love those characters. I could have watched a 45-minute episode of them just doing their laundry, you know, or just having dinner, and I would have eaten it up and bloody loved it. I know, you know, with the writers and stuff, and like, oh, we need all this drama, we need explosions, and we need conflict to always happen and be interesting. But I think the sign of really excellent writing can come down to little moments, like these little stories, where they may not be groundbreaking, they may not be, like, hugely plot-driven. You know, they could have probably, maybe with the exception of Momo and the footprint right at the end, they could have not done this entirely. And we can go into the next episode and you wouldn't have really missed anything, but you would have missed those characters just in this world. And they're clearly so comfortable with these characters, and the voice acting is so good and so great as well. And the world is so kind of well imagined. You can just enjoy being part of it because it's just that strong. So I love that. And structurally, it's very easy for me to talk about because I can just go in order of the stories they showed. So I love how it's kind of split up like that. There's an episode of Walking Dead that does the same thing. It's like, you know, this is Rick's story. And then there's a thing where he's the focus. And then it goes to Negan or it goes to Michonne, stuff like that. I think it's in season 8. And I was like, that's really well structured, that. So to see that, you know, Avatar did this years and years before that, and I'm sure plenty of shows have done it as well that I haven't seen. It's just, I think it's such a good structure. Because you can include a lot of people in it then, but it can feel quite tightly paced and tightly written because not that much is going to be happening between them all. But it still says so much about the characters. And, you know, an episode like this, if you did this, like, this was the third episode of the entire show or something, it would have been like, okay. But because we know the characters so well, we know some of their nuances, they can really shine. So I love that they found the opportunity to do an episode like this. And did it when you didn't necessarily need to, but oh my god. Because I was quite excited to see how the Ba Sing Se stuff was going to go on and continue and stuff, and I was like, oh, what's that going to be about? But as soon as this started, I was just so into it. And I feel like it made a lot of sense, because this isn't a problem that's going to be solved for them overnight. You know, they don't really know what they're going to do about it yet. So they might as well just go about their days, because they're waiting to, you know, see the king or whatever. So yeah, I bloody adored it. Definitely my favourite of the season, I think, but I think this is probably my favourite episode of the entire show. Hopefully people don't say, this one sucks, what are you on about, nothing happens. Hopefully that's not the case. I feel like that would be the case, because even like some of the weaker episodes that I've personally had with Avatar, stuff has happened. And this is more so character development and stuff moving forward with them rather than plot, and I'm perfectly okay with that, because, you know, it's bloody brilliant. Okay, so we had Toph and Katara's story off first. I liked that they kind of grouped those two together. You know, it's not, when we have explored that pairing and it's been like the focal point of an episode, they've kind of been arguing about it, really. So to see them just getting along and seeing how comfortable but not Toph is with herself, we kind of see almost a facade that she puts on, where she's like just fully confident. She's very confident in her abilities and what she can do and everything like that. But like she was saying, you know, if I'm blind, I don't need to worry about appearances all that much for both herself and other people. But then we kind of see that that's really not all the case, and she's actually quite vulnerable when it comes to that. So I love them exploring that, and Katara just being like, you know what, let's just have a girls' day out, let's have a spa day, just get all glammed up, basically. And I think that gave Toph a confidence she didn't even know it would give her. As she was saying, I'm not really used to this kind of thing, this isn't my sort of deal, considering, you know, where she came from and like her rich family and stuff. The fact that she's not really used to that kind of thing says a lot about her as well, which she's kind of so far removed. She couldn't go out for a spa day with her mum or anything, I imagine. She doesn't have any siblings because they kind of always kept her in that one little complex. So to see her kind of just have that moment to relax and feel refreshed or whatever was really nice. And that probably gave her like a sense of, wow, you know, I feel good about myself. I feel good within myself other than just my awesome powers that I'm very good at. That's kind of her big prowess. That's the thing she's super confident in. And that just comes across as confidence in herself, even though it's more so, I think, just confidence in her abilities. I don't think it's like, she's not ashamed of being blind or anything, and she shouldn't be, because, I mean, look at what she can bloody do. You know, I can't even do that, and I can fucking see, you know? But when it comes to those little bitchy girls, just say, you're a clown maker. Oh, she had bloody mini mouse ears or whatever. You know, that kind of struck a chord with her, and I think it showed that she does care about that stuff if she had the chance to. She just never really had the chance to now, so she's kind of realising, oh, damn, maybe I do kind of care about how others may perceive me in that sense. Because we've had, like, oh, she's disagreed about how much she contributes to a group or how she should contribute to a group. They've disagreed about plans and stuff. It's never come down to, haha, your makeup looks ugly. And that's such a kind of a real personal attack more than anything else I think we've seen in regards to Toph before. And she is still just a kid, and she's going to be very emotionally vulnerable about that. And she hasn't really had to deal with any of that because she has been kind of so isolated and kept inside by her parents most of her life. She hasn't really had to deal with shitty people like that. So that's going to be really sad to see. And the fact that she was like trying to hide the fact that she was crying and upset, while saying, you know, I don't need to care about that, so it's fine. I don't know whether or not Katara actually did notice she was crying. I feel like she might have done. But she's like, I know it doesn't matter, but you do look really pretty. That was so lovely to just see those two kind of stand together after how many disagreements they have, because that is probably something Katara, would she ever experienced it? She may have seen it, because I doubt the people in, you know, her village and stuff growing up were like, haha, Katara, your makeup's ugly as hell, because they seem quite tightly knit and stuff. But I'm sure she's kind of aware that that kind of thing would go about, because she was much more open and active in the world, and she'd been travelling with Aang and Sokka for quite a bit before she'd seen and met Toph anyway. But just that moment of solidarity and support and the bitchy girls getting their comeuppance was always nice to see. Swept off to sea, never to be seen again. So that was fun to kind of see them get their own back. And I think, you know, what they turned into and what they turned to, no matter all their insecurities, was their powers that they've kind of always excelled at. And that's what Toph and Katara kind of used to get their own back against those girls. You know, sticks and stones may break my bones, but my powers can drown you, is probably the new expression, I would say. So yeah, I love them kind of just standing together, fighting back. Katara, you know, saying what she wished someone would say to her as well, I guess. And the fact that it's just probably girls being jealous, and Toph doesn't need to feel ashamed about how she appears anyway. It was just a lovely little moment between the two of them. I love that kind of solidarity and that closeness that they've kind of formed. You know, can you imagine the idea of spending a whole day at a spa or something with Toph a few episodes back? Katara would have been like, no way in hell am I spending an entire day just with her. And now, you know, they're really good friends. And just wholesome. And I loved Katara sticking up for Toph. I love that vulnerable side of Toph that we haven't gotten that much of, because it's something she hasn't really needed to experience until now. And that she can enjoy kind of the simple pleasures in life like that. I just thought it was a lovely moment between the two of them. So I loved that so, so much. Then we had Iroh. Probably my favourite of the little stories in the episode, but oh my god. That was emotional as hell. Again, I talk about a lot of the lighting in this show. That shot of him just singing by the tree, like the sun and everything. Oh, so mwah. But he was just going around, helping people out, making things better. You know, even for a flower, he made their day better. Talking that guy down for mugging him and telling him how to be a better mugger at first, which wasn't the best. But, you know, just showing someone that he believes in them, a complete stranger, but he believes that they can be the best person they can be. He's probably used to trying to push that onto Zuko as well. He knows Zuko can be, you know, the best he can be. Once we're so used to that, I imagine Zuko is quite... If you're going to convince Zuko to believe in himself a bit, you can probably convince anyone. So I loved everything with that and that guy when he was singing to the kids to calm them down and relax and make them laugh after they were crying. And it was the same song, you know, a song about a soldier coming home. When it then got to the bit with the son, like the photo of his son, I was like, oh, is that why he's singing about the soldier coming home? Because he wished his son did. And, you know, it's like a big regret. And it was his birthday. And, oh, my God. That was just so beautiful. Just the idea that he spends every waking moment making lives better for people. Not being asked to. He just does it. That's just who he is. He likes healing people, making them better. But he's a man with so much pain inside himself that probably will never be healed, and no one can probably heal for him, because it's not like they can just bring his son back or absolve him of his guilt or whatever. So the fact that he does all that, and he's just such a happy, bubbly, cheery guy, and this huge, bright personality most of the time, but he's actually, like, really sad. Oh, that's... I don't want to talk about this one too much, because I'm just getting emotional even thinking about it, but that was so beautifully done. And then when they did like a tribute to, they said Mako, I think that's the actor who voiced Iroh. I believe he died in between series 2 and 3 being made, so I think there's a different voice actor for Iroh in season 3, if Iroh's in season 3. I feel like I've heard that. So that'll be interesting when we get to that point, but... I know that the original actor did die while they were making the show. So that's going to make me sad. I don't know if they just recast him or if they just retire the character because of the voice actor. I don't know. I imagine they probably had the whole story planned out for a while. So I imagine Iroh continues on. But that's we'll cross that bridge when we get to it. But oh, just seeing, you know, the positive impact he has on people he doesn't even know. But then the person who he's probably really close to and closest to for the longest time and the longest portion of his life is one he can't make things better for, even though he absolutely wishes that would be the case. And he just sings that song. I can just imagine him singing that song to his son when he was a little boy or something, whenever he was crying. So that's how he instinctively knew to do the same thing with that kid. And he's... On the day he's dealing with the loss of his son as well. And he's like, oh, you know, it's not a romantic picnic or anything. It's a very special occasion, though, because nothing could be more special to him than, like, the bond he had with his son and the fact that his son's not here anymore. Whew, man, that was so beautiful. As soon as I stop recording, I'm watching his segment again because, oh, my God, that was incredibly well done. I almost wish that's how the episode ended on his, but it probably wouldn't have worked with Zuko's story at the same time, timing-wise. But man, they really like just punch you in the throat like a third of the way through the episode. Rude. But a whole beautiful segment all over again just shows the power of Iroh's character, what a lovely kind of guy he is. He should, you know, he's who we all aspire to be. And no matter how like bubbly and cheery and how much you make people laugh, you know, you don't know what people are going through. And that's probably one of the hardest days of the year for him. And he spent it just making people's lives better. And then just mourning his son, having a moment with him, singing that song. Seeing him break down as well. Seeing Iroh cry. That will fuck me up for the rest of my days, seeing Iroh cry. Never again, please. So yeah, beautiful story with him. Then with Aang, I liked that they focused on like a bond with animals in a sense, or him feeling empathy for animals. His, you know, the most precious animal to him is still missing. So the idea of him trying to just give them a space where they can be safe and protected and happy is all he wants for Appa right now. And he's still kind of on the hunt for that. But, you know, he's still taking the time to make things better for other people. making things better for other animals, potentially, for the most part, apart from maybe household pets. All on his mind, he's probably like, but this isn't the animal I really want to find and make their day better for. But still, it was a really lovely kind of thing that he did, and it just showcased how great his earthbending's becoming as well. Like, he made that whole last thing, like the little zoo area for them. That was incredible. So you're seeing, in terms of, I guess, like general plot and character stuff as well, how far and how well he's developing with his earthbending. He's getting better and better at that, because that's kind of the deal of this season or this book, isn't it? So that was a nice way of having a little side story that can relate to, you know, Aang's absence of Appa right now, tying it to like freeing animals and giving them a safe space where, you know, God knows how Appa is in terms of a safe space right now, while tying it into his character of him getting better and better at earthbending. And he's just like, yeah, you know, I think a few episodes back, like the episode where Sokka was stuck in the hole or whatever, you know, you couldn't have imagined him making a whole ass like zoo for people, but he's come on leaps and bounds. So that's really cool to see that development in him as well. And yeah, just the determination he had to, I mean, freeing all of the animals at once was probably a really terrible idea, but I liked the comedy of it. The cabbage guy, got to shout out the cabbage guy, like that poor man. He's probably aged 50 years in 5 months. But yeah, that was a really nice kind of thing to see Aang do and go through. He's been so all-consumed with Appa's disappearance at first, and then I think he realised that that's not going to be how they find him. He can't get too up in himself about that. And then there's the whole thing with Ba Sing Se and the war, and that's probably really frustrating for him. But he knows that the focus still needs to be on Appa as well. But he probably saw the potential of what Appa's going through and all those animals. He's like, you know, I can improve their quality of life, improve their days, give them some freedom. You know, he wants to free Appa, but he could free all these other animals at the same time. Just shows a lot about, you know, what he can do and what he can focus on as well. Then we had Sokka's story, and I mean, it started from him, you know, staring at some girls, which, again, not great, but when he got kicked in there and it kind of became a rap battle, it just shows, I think, the underestimation of his intelligence. You're just like, oh, you can't do all these kind of certain syllable things, these haikus and stuff, and he just took to it very quickly. But then, in classic Sokka style, I think he got a bit too big for his boots. His head got that bit too big, then he went too far and too many syllables with it. But the fact that he was just so in tune with, you know, the spoken word and that kind of thing, making these rhymes, making these haikus, just again, his intelligence that sometimes people, I think, overlook when they're facing Team Avatar, and that's sometimes their downfall, because he comes up with all these different strategies and plans and stuff. So we've seen that he is a very smart guy, and I like that this kind of did showcase that. And you know, to see him square off with this other woman who just completely overlooked him and just rolled her eyes at him. I mean, not entirely unfair given the circumstances of how they met, but, you know, you can kind of see that he's a bit of an idiot. But I think I've said before, he's like a very clever idiot. He's a genius imbecile. So I like that this stayed true to that side of his character, but you know, he can have a way with words, as I think we've also seen in the past. But yeah, bit of a lovable goof in many ways, and he's still very much learning, I think. But yeah, it was just kind of a summarisation. He's very intelligent, he can do this kind of thing, but he's also very prone to going too much into it, too far up his own arse, essentially. And that proved to be his downfall, but again, that's kind of classic Sokka, so like they just kind of symbolised and grinded down his character to that kind of essence and focused on that for his little story. And again, it's just one of his little things. He's just going around, walking around, and got himself into that mess, which again, he does have a bit of a habit of doing. So yeah, I like what that kind of just said about, yeah, same old Sokka, essentially. But there is a lot of intelligence to him that can go unnoticed, but when it comes to that side of things, I think he can be his own worst enemy, so that's something for him to work through, which I'm sure he will once he just grows up and matures a bit. You know, he's still very young as well. So yeah, really enjoyed his story. Then we had Zuko's story, which again, I very much enjoyed. I also liked Iroh kind of just being like the matchmaker in the situation, and we saw he had his own things going on in this episode, but then he also takes the time to be like, hey Zuko, go and be on a happy little date, and then checking how it went when he came back. Like, such a good father figure to everyone. Love that man. But yeah, it was a cool insight, I guess, to another reason why his situation being on the run and stuff, you know, it's not going to be like the perfect way of living. And a lot of work will probably need to go into properly settling down, making a life for himself, wherever it may be ultimately. But yeah, just seeing Zuko go on a date, something I wasn't expecting to see, certainly not anytime soon. But I really liked what they did with it, and just showing like this is probably something you can't get too close to anyone really right now. And I think he became more and more aware of that. But it was nice, I think, just the hope and at least trying it, like a trial run, I guess. And you know, this is how life could be. This is the life you probably should have had in a loving home somewhere, you know, where your biggest concern was maybe like who you liked and which girl liked you back or whatever, rather than being on the run and your father being a dick and all the kind of power struggles that come with it, your sister's after you, you know, your mum's gone. But it's just, I guess, yeah, the tragedy of how Zuko's life's gone. And because of his situation right now, you know, you can get as close as you like to someone, but that's just going to maybe put you in more danger and them in more danger. Because right from the, you know, second they kind of introduced themselves, you know, he was lying, saying, oh, I'm Lee. So kind of had just this one night, I guess, where he could just pretend that he wasn't who he really was. And, you know, Lee's got a pretty good life in Ba Sing Se, but unfortunately, Lee is just one aspect of, you know, a larger person of who he really is. But just those moments of like sweetness and vulnerability that we saw in Zuko, you know, when he was trying to juggle through his lies and he couldn't do it. I loved him kind of lighting up all the spots in the girl's favourite place, because that's what she wanted to see. You could see how disappointed she was. And then you could see him almost go in for like a second kiss, but think better of it, because again, probably can't get too close to someone. So that's really sad that it kind of works out that way, because she did seem genuinely interested in him. I love that, you know, when it came to her asking questions about him and what he, you know, where he was before, what his name was, you know, it wasn't, oh, how did you get your scar then? You know, what happened to your face? I love that no mention was made to that whatsoever. That wasn't even the point. I thought that was a really nice touch as well, that they just kind of, doesn't even matter. So, it was cool to see him kind of have that connection with someone outside of like Iroh, for example. And he was just living his life. This is like the first time he probably actually got to be a teenage boy in God knows how long. So I really enjoyed that. Just another kind of human side to things. And the sad fact of life for him is that's one of the most normal things he's probably ever done in his life. But it's something he can't quite have just yet, maybe ever, because of who he really is in his situation and stuff. So I like them exploring that. And he's not allowing himself to get too close to her, obviously. He can't get in too deep, I guess, when he's in a situation like this. But he still can do like nice things for her. And I loved a little moment where he kind of like slammed the door shut when he got back and then opened it a bit like, yeah, I had a nice time, thanks. You know, it probably made Iroh feel a bit better, because I imagine he was a bit worried when that happened. But he did genuinely have a good time with someone that he's completely unfamiliar with. He shared a connection with. That's probably not, again, something he's not very used to, forming proper connections with someone for a very long time. Like, most of the relationships he does have are quite antagonistic, like with Azula, Team Avatar, for example. And yeah, hit the Avatar bingo card of me talking about that scene between Aang and Zuko in season one, when Aang's like, you know, we could have been really good friends if we'd not known each other when we were kids. You know, that was a potential moment for him to create like a positive bond with someone or have like an intimate moment like that. He chose to like attack them and ruin it. Then when it comes to this, you know, they had a kiss, and then he had to kind of force himself away from that. So he's continuing to kind of choose to not take that next step. Someone's kind of reaching out a hand to him. He can't take it, even though, you know, certainly in this occasion, I think he probably wanted to. So it's kind of sad to see how that unfolded. But I think it's also kind of hopeful that he's clearly capable of having that kind of bond with someone, that kind of relationship, and maybe one day that is something he can properly form really nicely. So I don't know if we're going to see any more of that kind of continue, because it did feel kind of like, you know, just a short anthology of little one-off scenes. But I like it as sort of a promise or a hope for Zuko's future. It's just not quite the right time, but he could just be, you know, a teenager for, you know, one very rare night. I imagine Iroh also probably appreciated having that particular night to himself. It's probably a good space just to be alone. But of course, he also wants what's best for his nephew, so he's kind of like, yeah, go for it, be a bit of a matchmaker, because he's going to get excited about that kind of thing. And he wants his nephew to be happy as well. So, you know, the fact that there was a bit of hope to that at the end, where he was like, yeah, I had a nice time. Very wholesome. That kind of bit of vulnerability to his character that I really enjoy seeing. Normally he does that, you know, in private and stuff, like when he was screaming at the storm or whatever and allowed himself to cry then. But that was just a little bit of him opening up to, you know, being honest about his kind of emotions, being emotionally vulnerable a bit in front of someone else. You know, that's kind of still a big step for him as well. Obviously it's the person he trusts the most. But I'd still really enjoyed that. And I liked that Iroh was like, oh, good. Wholesome. So I liked everything with Zuko's story and what that kind of could potentially mean for his character later on down the line, and the tragedy of like it happening right now. It was just nice to see him have a good time, do something nice for someone as well. Again, just almost following in Iroh's footsteps slightly, just like someone who barely knows her, you know, basically a complete stranger. But he just showed them a good time. In my head, just sounds kind of wrong. But, you know, he did something nice for her, you know, made her day better by lighting up all the kind of candle-y bits and stuff. I liked him doing that, like, just like, he was like finger-gunning it. It's great, super smooth. And I like that he can do it. It's not just like a huge explosion of flame and it's like super loud and everything. He was just doing quite subtly. She didn't even question really, she did question how he did it, but then completely glossed over it because that wasn't important. So I like that she wasn't entirely aware of, you know, the fact that he's a firebender and stuff, but any hints of that side of him, she completely ignored. And I thought that was actually quite wholesome because it was just about Zuko. Because for her, it's just Lee who works at the tea place. And that was more than enough for her to be interested in him. So I like that, you know, there are some aspects of Zuko that people are clearly very much into and they can really like love about him. So I'd like to think maybe he's aware of that now, but long way to go, of course, for both his character and his plot, for him to ever be in a position where he could properly relax like that, I think, and have a relationship. But it was really lovely to kind of see that explored. And then finally, we have Momo's little story. I love that they capped it off with Momo. It's quite funny. I get why they included it as the last one, because it was kind of the one, if any, that had some sort of plot impact potentially. So it was like confirmation, Appa's here, maybe in that general area. I don't know quite what's going on with that. An insight into Ba Sing Se and like animal trading, I guess. That was why Appa was taken in the first place. I think they said like, he sold him on. And we seem to get a look into that in this one, where Momo and like the cat slash dog tigery slash panthery things chasing him all got locked away. So I'm guessing it's part of the trade. I'm guessing maybe that's to do with whatever happened to Appa right now. Because, you know, wherever Momo was taken, he ended up being fairly close to that footprint and stuff. Because it didn't take too long for the dog panther things to track down the scent of him. So I like that we're getting some hints at where Appa could be and what's going on with that. So I'm sure we're pretty close to getting some definitive answers with that revelation. Although I don't know if Appa was actually really aware that he was lying in the footprint. I think that was just more for us as the audience. That's why he like zoomed out and stuff. I think he was just kind of focused on, you know, Appa's bit of hair, and that's kind of all he had. And it made me really sad, actually, that Appa is clearly very much on Momo's mind, and he really missed him. He's like having dreams about, you know, food, yes, but Appa was getting him there and stuff like that. When he found like a tuft of hair, he just wrapped it around so Appa was like always close to him. Wholesome. I love the bond that those two have kind of built up. And it makes sense that there is a closeness there now, because they had a whole little story to themselves, I think. Was it the swamp episode? They kind of had a little side story where it was just the two of them getting up to a bit of trouble. So we have seen them kind of have time alone to bond and stuff. So I love that he just really misses his buddy. He's like, I don't know, I see him as like siblings almost, like a bigger little brother. I feel like he just misses his big brother. So I love that he kind of kept that close, just going on his little adventures. He's like trying to look for him and stuff like that. Getting caught up in trouble, thinking he's seeing him, but it's actually not. So that was actually, I mean, bittersweet, because it's bloody sad that poor little Momo was all like sad when he wasn't finding him. But wholesome that they do have that bond. And I like that even though those panthery things were chasing them down, and you know, they probably would have had him for dinner, when it all came down to it, he still let them out of their cages, and they have to. I don't think Momo realised it, but they did pay him back in kind and like led him to whoever he was looking for, in a way. But I don't know if Momo really clicked that it was a big footprint. But still, it shows some nice development for Momo, I guess, in terms of himself, that he didn't hold a grudge, he did let those people out. You know, we go back to Toph and Katara with the girls, they just swept them out to sea. And then we have Momo, you know, they were going to eat him. And he still kind of releases them because he feels that empathy. Maybe if Appa wasn't missing, he wouldn't have done that, because he's just more aware of empathy for other creatures, I guess, right now, because he's wondering where his buddy is. He's feeling sad about it. So I like that he chose to still let them out. And that is potentially kind of a big plot thing if Momo kind of realises what he's actually found, and relays that somehow to Aang and the others. So that was a nice little kind of wholesome bit to end on as well. I really did enjoy a glimpse into Momo's story and the fact that he's missing Appa and some big developments there. But yeah, overall, hell of an episode. I bloody adored it. I'm going to be thinking about this episode for ages, I just know it. Especially Iroh's section, that was definitely my favourite. I mean, I'm sad to say, I think I love my boy Sokka, we know he's my favourite, but I do feel like his was probably the weakest one. But I don't feel the need to really like rank them and say this is better than this or whatever. Because I just really enjoyed the structure of the episodes, doing something a bit different. I think, you know, it's just a case of, out of all of them, Sokka's felt like, well, good old, same old Sokka, and then maybe it wasn't as much maybe development plot or character-wise, or it's not really tying to any particular theme or plot point we've had in the past. Other than just, well, we know what Sokka's like, there he is. Because we know he's intelligent and stuff. But yeah, I really enjoyed all the stories and what they had to say. Great structure, you know, all the little stories just kind of fly by. Very fucking emotional with Iroh's bit. And, you know, Momo's bit at the end was quite sad as well. And Toph, what they had going on with her. So we got some really lovely development. I love that they just focus on the characters, and that is more than enough to be incredibly entertaining, incredibly engaging. And yeah, just a really beautiful kind of moment to breathe, I guess. And yeah, I'm kind of blown away by it. I could talk about this for a long time. I literally, just before, well, I got about halfway through talking about Zuko's story and the camera cut out. We ran out of battery, which has never happened before when I've done Avatar. So I've clearly been talking about this episode longer than I ever have about any. So that probably says a lot about how much I adored this. But, you know, when you have such strong characters, just use them, you know. Don't make it all about plot. And I like that they're aware enough to do that, and they trust these characters enough to do that. So yeah, beautiful episode from start to finish. I adored it. I almost feel bad for the next episode having to follow something as powerful as this. But I'm sure it'll still be great because it's Avatar. But, I need to stop talking about this episode now. But I bloody loved it. Easily my favourite of the season. I think I will go as far as to say this is my favourite episode of the show so far. I just, wow. I want to write an essay on this. That's how passionate I am. I want to write an essay. I shouldn't need to write essays anymore because uni was years ago, but oh, I could, yeah. I'm going to be thinking about a lot of this for quite some time, particularly the Iroh section, but yeah. Such an incredible episode. I adored it. Hopefully you all didn't hate it, and I'm the only person in the world who's like, well, I really enjoyed it. You know, I think, I don't want to say like it's a filler episode. In terms of plot, I guess it is, but I think this is a filler episode done right, you know? And done very bloody right, I would say. So yeah, I adore this. That's all I can really say without repeating myself and just turning into a blubbery mess thinking about Iroh. So yeah, loved it. And that's going to be everything for now. Until my next reaction, thanks for watching.